Hey listeners, welcome back to another out-of-the-world new story with Revolving Time, where we bring you real-life stories that explore the complexities of the human experience. We hope that our stories have provided you with insights, inspiration, and a renewed appreciation for the power of human resilience. Okay, let's go to the story and see what happened there.
Published by J-Rob. My wife's good friend wants something I love giving, and allow me to go down. Full story. I hope you will enjoy this. My wife Jennifer works at a local hospital as a nurse. The pressure is high and the days long as the hospital has suffered through some cutbacks. Every so often the nurses, mostly women, break the tension with a little naughty talk. Out of the ears of the supervisor and the patient, of course. But little digs about their love life or midnight escapades. Sometimes, buoyed with a bottle of wine, Jennifer would tell me about some of those conversations. Linda's boyfriend had a smaller than average stick. Linda says, he doesn't satisfy her. Kathy was the real naughty one, a ditzy blonde with a smile that lighted a room. Her hubby Rick loved to ride up the chocolate speedway, as she called it, and she allowed him to do so on official holidays. Those holidays were his birthday, New Year's Eve, their anniversary, and Thanksgiving. Oh, and since her hubby had to travel on the job, sometimes when he'd return from a profitable sales trip. The other member of the Fantastic Five, as they called themselves, was Chantel, who apparently had a husband who liked getting love in the car. Often, they have their date night, which is normally having a babysitter over while they do a dinner and movie. After the movie, they end up parked down by Johnson's Pond. At least they did until nearly getting busted by the cops. She was so embarrassed. Luckily, they had enough notice to get presentable. But it was embarrassing because one of the cops was a friend of her dad. Good thing she was with her husband. My wife thought all of their talk was disgusting. But she never said whether she said anything about our love life. I imagine so, because everyone else seemed so open. Still, Jennifer was a little private with her love life. She still insisted we do it in the dark. From time to time, the husbands would join the wives for dinner after work, at holiday parties, and a few times on Saturday evening group dates. We'd been to a comedy club and a local version of a Broadway show in recent months. It was sort of strange at these gatherings, knowing what I knew about the private love lives of the other couples. I mean, I had to wonder if Ted's stick was as small as Linda made it sound. Or if when Chantel and Mike disappeared from the comedy club for a half hour between sets, supposedly to go to the restroom, whether they had really went out to the car for a quickie. Of course, this was all harmless mind wrestling. I mean, there never was a time when the guys talked about their love lives with their wives. Nothing like the girls talked, anyway. Every once in a while, I wondered what Jennifer said about me in the sack. I mean, we had a decent love life. The Saturday night, date night kind. Nothing really kinky or anything. Sometimes we'd vary things, but normally it was love by the numbers. After a warm bath, Jennifer would come to bed. We'd make out a little, I'd play with her for a while. She'd dot my stick a little, and then I'd mount and do her for a while before she got on top to come. Sometimes that would get me off too. But normally after she came, I'd get back on top and finish. Every once in a while, she'd let me do her style. But that was about as kinky as we got. I'd try to vary the action. But she really didn't like receiving love or giving full B jobs. It was disappointing. Not so much the lack of B jobs, but her dislike of rao love herself. I've always loved the action between a girl's legs. But that wasn't anything Jennifer enjoyed. Before I met Jennifer, I had dated several women who loved me being between their legs. Donna was a screamer, a trait I didn't really like, but figured out a way to subdue her while still getting her off. Good old 69. Yes, getting my stick in her mouth was a way to quiet her, while I still got to munch on my favorite meal. The only thing about Donna was that she'd sometimes lose control while we were in the midst of a heavy session, and she'd nip my stick with her teeth. Ouch. Susan was quite different. There were times when she'd surprise me when I'd visit her apartment, Come in, she'd call when I knocked on her door. Once, I opened it to see her with her fingers playing with her poo -ssy in a love seat across the way from the door. My first thought was that it was a good thing I hadn't brought a friend over with me. That would have been embarrassing. Yes, I liked going down on women. But it's something my wife Jennifer just didn't enjoy. So although I'd continue to ask, it never got me anywhere. Several weeks ago, we had the group over to our house for cocktails and cards. We played Texas Hold'em poker for a couple hours, while talking politics, sports, and the weather. Nothing all too exciting, just friends getting together and interacting. During one of the breaks, Kathy and I found ourselves alone in the kitchen, grabbing refills. So, I hear you like eating out, said the woman, suggestively. I nearly spit out my wine. I was about all I could stammer. At lunch, she said. I heard you like eating out of the building, rather than in the cafeteria. With that, she smacked me on the shoulder and went back to the living room laughing. I couldn't believe what she had said. My immediate thought was she was talking about the bedroom desire I had that Jennifer didn't. But as she left, I supposed it could have been merely a bit of a dig, or maybe just coincidence. Nothing else was said that night, and I went to bed wondering whether I was being made fun of or what. Over the next month, there were a couple occasions when I'd run into Kathy, and she'd make similar comments. She once asked if I had ever eaten at the Y, which could have meant the Y between a woman's legs or merely the downtown Y. Still, all the innuendo got my mind working. I wondered if Jennifer had told of my bedroom desires to her friends. I couldn't imagine she had, but there were too many little throwaway lines by Kathy that had me wondering. I do know that several times when Jennifer and I were making love, I'd find my mind wandering toward poo-ssy. I wished Jennifer would let me her, but it wasn't to me. Update. Over the next week, I was in the midst of snafu after snafu at work. Outsources screwed up. My most trusted employee screwed up. Everything was working out wrong. My mind was on anything but love, as each day was long, and I was turning in early to get back to the office even earlier. The following week wasn't much better, as the screw-ups continued. Finally, on Wednesday, the tide started to turn. Instead of a storm of bad occurrences, there were only a few. Mid-morning, I told my secretary I needed to hit the bank and the local coffee bistro. It was time for a good cup of Java and a deep breath. Grabbing my laptop, I hopped into the car and took care of banking before grabbing a latte. Sitting in the shop, immersed in responding to emails, I had a female ask if a seat was taken. I waved at her, thinking she wanted to take the chair. Rob, came the reply. It was Kathy. Do you mind if I sit down? She asked in mock anger. Of course not, I said, coming to my senses. I was just in the middle of something and thought you wanted to borrow the chair. We spoke for a while, a little this and that. I mentioned work was a bear. She noted her job was its normal craziness. Had to take off today for a couple doctor's appointments and to take care of some of my dad's stuff, said the brunette co-worker of my wife. Plus, Rick has been on the road this week, and that meant I had some other things that had to get done that he'd normally do. The conversation was pretty tame until Kathy gave me a mischievous smile. What? I asked. You never told me if you liked dining at the Y, said the girl with a big grin. I asked what she was talking about, stammering something about eating at the office for most of the last couple weeks because of the workload. Oh, I don't imagine your secretary, gives you lunch. Kathy. I'm just kidding you, chill out, said my wife's co-worker. I stared at the woman and then asked, what has Jennifer told you, you know, about that? Kathy smiled at me. My, now you are interested, laughed the woman. Now you want to talk, openly. What do you want to know? Asking if Jennifer had talked about our love life? Kathy admitted she had. That all the Fab Five did. Oh, not all the details, just some of the little things. The things that hit a chord. Like the chocolate speedway, I asked. Kathy turned red as she nodded yes. So what did she say about me? My wife's co-worker smiled again. Just that you are always pestering her for something. I mean, we all sort of talk about our guys pestering for something or another. I mean, Rick always wants to go back there. But I don't really like to do it often. It hurts a lot, you know. But for special occasions we do it. He loves it. And Jennifer? You should be proud. She always has said you take care of her needs in the bedroom. She says you are caring and hot. That you are a great lover. Now it was my turn to turn beet red. But she does complain that you are always pressuring for her do let you do. That I told the girl I had always liked doing it. And that I wished Jennifer would let me. But that I was over it. I just wished it wasn't hands or lips off, so to speak. I know what you mean, said Kathy. Huh? It's a good thing we were alone in the coffee shop. Or else our talk might have raised eyebrows. Rick doesn't like to go down on me. He hates it. What is worse is that he will do it. But it's half-hearted, and when he just goes through the motions, I hate it too, said the girl. It was always a big part of my lovemaking, but not with Rick. For him, it is disgusting. I don't even allow him to attempt it anymore, saying I am too sensitive down there. He buys it, probably because he hates doing it so much. The two of us spoke a little while longer before heading out. Outside, by her car, she dropped the bomb. Look, Rob, I love Rick, and I know you love Jennifer. I would not want to do anything to harm those relationships. But I have a need, and it's something you can fix. I would never cheat on Rick. But, well, I'm not sure doing what we like is cheating, if you know what I mean. With that, Kathy started her car, backed out, and sped off, leaving me with a hard-on and a jumbled mind. The girl just propositioned me, so to speak. At least I think she did. My wife's good friend said she would allow me to go down on her. Wow. Update. The following Saturday night, you would have never known Kathy and I had talked at the coffee shop. We were at her house for another card game, and she barely spoke with me all night. At home that night, Jennifer and I had raucous love as I banged my wife with visions of Kathy's poo-SSY in my mind. Was she a true blonde? Was she natural, trimmed, or shaven down there? Did she moan or grimace when she was being licked? On that evening, I imagined all. Tuesday morning, my secretary interrupted me with notice of a call. I'm not sure who it is, she said. Kathy, a friend of your wife. It was Kathy, and we made chit-chat for a minute before she hit me with the bombshell. Look, I've never done this, but Rick it out west the week until Sunday. And, well, I have a need you can fill, something you like to do. I think I dazzled even myself with the response. Uh-huh. Okay, it wasn't worthy of a notation in a book of quotations, but it was all I could come up with. So, cooed the girl, want to dine at the Y? Have lunch between some willing thighs? Make a poo-SSY purr? When? Today, you get a lunch break, right? How about coming over? And I will fix you up something special. I know you will like it. See you at noon. It was a conversation I will never forget. I worried it was a setup. What if Jennifer was over the house when I got there? I quickly called the hospital, only to have Jennifer say she couldn't talk because they were short-staffed and up to their ears in patients. I thought of how wrong it was. But then I thought about how right it would be to taste a pretty poo-SSY for the first time in years. Besides, Kathy said it wasn't cheating. It wasn't, was it? The devil in me won out. I made my way over to Kathy and Rick's house for my noon date. I don't remember a minute of the trip. My stick was hard, though, and I had visions of what Kathy might look like, whether she was putting me on and whether she'd put out. Pulling into the driveway right behind her hybrid, tried to appear as innocent as I could as I walked up the walkway to her front door. There was a note saying, "Come in." I knocked anyway, opening the door slowly. "Kathy." "In here," came the response. Kathy and Rick's house had a family room in the back, overlooking woods. I strode slowly toward the family room, stopping at the doorway. Across the room, in a pink chiffon nightie and black stockings, was my wife's co-worker. She had a book in her hands, candles on the desk. "You came over, I wondered if you would," said Kathy. "You were very quiet on the phone." Explaining how nervous I was, I said I almost didn't come. "I don't want to cheat on Jennifer." Kathy gave a realistic explanation. "Look, we are not going to have love. Never. Won't happen. But there is something you can do that I don't think is cheating." With that, she uncrossed her legs, giving me an upskirt shot of her panties. The look was fantastic. The stockings were held up by garters, the panties light pink set off perfectly by the pitch black nylons. "Adorable, lovey, hot. So, are you hungry?"
"Famished."
Kathy smiled and began to unhook the garter snaps from her stockings. Unhooked, she stood, reached into the elastic of her panties, and slowly removed them from her midsection and slowly rolled them down her legs. Sitting back down, I walked over to her and dropped to my knees. Slipping a hand onto her thigh, I slowly slid it up to her womanhood, using my hand as a reverse vice to open her thighs to me. She was a little trimmed down there, but still had a full mane of hair above her poo-hash-ssy lips. She wasn't blonde, but brunette, down there. Not that it mattered. "Are you ready to eat your lunch, Rob? Well, are you?" I was. In fact, I dove right in. First, I put my hands below her as asterisk, with my thumbs pushing open her thighs a little more. I moved her legs over the arms of her chair, then began kissing up her leg, starting on the lovely black stockings right above the right knee. My lips continued. Soon I found my goal, holding the kiss for a bit. Soon I began kissing her. It was incredible, licking the hole between her legs. Kathy began grinding. I loved the taste. I loved feeling each inch of her. For her part, Kathy was quiet, except for some groans and grunts. Soon, though, she began to shake and cried out. I did as I was told. No question about it. "Oh my God, I'm caming," cried out the girl. "Yes." Somewhere along the way, I began rubbing my stick in my pants, and the sounds of her going over edge took me over the edge myself. For the first time in years, I came in my pants. All the while, I kept my head between her. Gasping, Kathy held my head in her hands and rocked against my face. "That's so very incredible, so wonderful," cried the girl. "You make me feel so very lovey and hot." I slid back on my haunches, admiring my work. Reaching over, I held her as asterisk and pulled her toward me. Now, Rob, remember." I laid down on the floor, pulling her toward me. Soon, her poo-hash-ssy was right above me, and I turned her around. Then I pulled her down toward my head. She got the idea, lowering her poo-hash-ssy to my lips once again. "Be careful, I'm sensitive after caming," was all she said. My mouth worked magic on her. "That was totally incredible. Did you enjoy it?" "Oh yes. It was my best lunch in years," I told her. We shared coffee before I had to head back to the office. We both swore ourselves to secrecy. We both promised not to ruin our friendship with anything that would take things to another level. "Look, Rob, I have needs, and I know you do too. This was a perfect morning. Let's not ruin it, okay?" "Okay, Kathy. But every time I look at you from now on, I will be thinking of this day."
"Me too."
I smiled at her. "Well, you know, there is another thing Jennifer won't do."
"Oh, what's that?"
"You know what you and Rick do on a holiday? She won't do that either." Kathy smiled, shook her head, and then laughed. "That, my friend, would be cheating."
"I guess it would."
The end. Thanks for watching. Remember, Revolving Time exists because of your support. Subscribe now, and let's uncover the hidden secrets and truths together.